Mic check. One. Mic check.
Good evening, friends. Welcome to Pendle Hill. My name is John Meyer. I am the education coordinator here at Pendle Hill, and I'm so glad to see Gar back here in the corner. You must have snuck in without me noticing, because we're going to want to put a microphone on you. So if you go over to see Julian over here in the gray sweater, he'll put that on for you. Meanwhile, I will orient you to Pendle Hill. Welcome. It's so nice to have you all here. For how many of you is this the first time you're being at Pendle Hill? Oh, how exciting is that? Yay. We're so glad you're here. I know some friends who said, oh, the last time I was here was in 1962. Right? 1962 was the last time you were here? Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So people go back and keep coming back and keep coming back, and we're glad to see all of you who are returning as well as the new faces.
Switch.
So what I would like to do is give you a brief orientation before we start our program and have our live streaming folks join us this evening, so we're happy to be able to do that. We've worked the kinks out of our equipment and got it all ready for those who couldn't be with us. Basically, you have all the information that you need in the package that you've been given, but it's similar to one of those hotel pieces that you probably won't ever sit down and read, so I'm going to go over a few pieces of information that are more or less vital to the way you need to operate. We have a hospitality cell phone. That telephone number is on the back of your name tag, which you should wear at all times while you're on campus. Your kind of questions: I need to pick up from the train, I need to be taken to the train, I need another set of towels, etc. Between the hours of 7:30 p.m. and 7:30 a.m., although the phone is answered, it's answered for emergency purposes. And what is an emergency? One is that you might lock yourself out of your bedroom. We don't expect you to stay out in your skivvies as you've gone out to the bathroom and not get back into your room. That is an emergency, totally appropriate. However, you can do the people who are sleeping at night a big favor by not closing your door when you leave to go to the restroom. Other emergencies: in the event of fire, first get out of the building and wait on the other side of the parking lot from the building in which you're in. Take your cell phone and call 911, and then call hospitality. In the event of the medical emergency, call 911, or have someone near you call 911, and they will respond, and then have someone call hospitality so that we can help emergency vehicles get to the right spot on campus where you are. The times and meals are all posted both on the bulletin boards all around campus, and they're in your program. We have meeting for worship for 1/2 hour of unprogrammed worship every morning at 8:30 to 9. Friends and non-friends are invited to join us for that period of silent worship, many people who are not friends find it nonetheless to be very helpful to center themselves for a period of deep quiet in the morning before we begin on some of the headier issues that will occupy us for the rest of the day, the heady and the hearty issues. Please turn off your cell phones and electronic devices for worship, and now would be a good time to do that. Pagers, cell phones, anything that rings. We are not responsible for lost or stolen items, and if you have any concerns, you ought to lock your room doors and keep your valuable items in your rooms. Please do not make telephone calls in public spaces on your cell phone. Go outside or into a hallway that where other people won't be affected by your speaking. Smoking is permitted only outside, and there are like portable ashtrays outside in a couple of places that you can use. We enjoy quiet time at Pendle Hill after Quaker midnight, which is what for all you Quakers? 10 o'clock, Quaker midnight. If you'd like to connect with Wi-Fi, the password is in your packet, and it's on blue and white striped notices on walls throughout the campus. I hate to talk about leaving so soon, since many of you haven't even gotten into your rooms yet, but I'm going to anyway. You're expected to be out of your rooms by 10 o'clock on Sunday morning. And if you would, please strip your bed of the linens on your bed, stuff them into your pillowcase along with your towels and washcloth, and place them outside in the hallway. And that's a sign to our housekeepers that you can they can go into your room and tidy up, vacuum, and remake the beds. Your keys should be returned to a gray metal box. There is one at the exits to each of the buildings and in several places, and there is also a receptacle next to the napkin holders in Main House. Or you can turn them into registration. There's also a gray metal box there. It's a gray metal box with a little slot on the top. If you should walk off with your key, which happens every now and again, and you decide you think it would be wise to mail it to us, please mail it between two pieces of cardboard that you have sealed. Otherwise, we get an envelope with a hole in it, and our taxpayer dollars are going to repair some kind of a postal machine that automatically has eaten it. So those are all of the hard and fast things that are related to Pendle Hill as a general matter. In this building, we're in the barn. This is our meeting for worship area that we have brought in. It's suitable and suiting and fitting that we have our conference in this room that has seen the likes of Douglas Steere and on Howard Brenton and many illuminating forebears of ours, including Vincent Harding, who has challenged us to carry on the tradition of this Quaker environment of being both a place for deep spiritual listening and also for acting in the world. Even if we are not of the world, we are in the world witnessing, and that's why we're here this weekend. So I want to tell you a little bit about, what's the sound system doing? From what, I've only got this mic on, what other one? Really? Okay, fine, let me continue then. Now I'm going to give you the welcome that I really had in mind, not just the little bits about this. I'm going to ask you to say, welcome to Lenape Hoking. We are on the land, the ancestral land of the Lenni Lenape. And they are located from the eastern seaboard through the Midwestern states, through Ohio, into Wisconsin, and down into Oklahoma. The Lenni Lenape are still here among us. And there are three recognized tribal nations, either state recognized or federally recognized, Lenni Lenape communities that have been in continuous operation with continuous leadership, two of which are in Delaware and one of which is located in New Jersey. So we honor those Native Americans who are with us in our community, and we honor the ancestors who have maintained this land and that we are heirs to at this point and trustees of the earth to take care of this land. And that's one of the reasons we're all here tonight. A number of people who cannot be with us tonight are witnessing in Standing Rock. And before we begin our program, I would like us all to settle into a period of worship and remember those people who are standing on the front lines against the military might of our nation that is arrayed against them, witnessing for clean water and the sanctity of the land. So would you please join me for a few moments of silent worship? press the top button. Oh, I forgot my brains too. Oh dear. There are lots of people to thank. You'll notice in our program that I have given you some list of the people to thank. I didn't put all the staff here at Pendle Hill, our kitchen staff, our hospitality staff, our registration staff. They're all involved. Everybody here helps everybody else. It is a community that pulls itself together. But I would like to thank all of those folks now, our advancement staff, our publicity staff, Lena Blunt, stand up for me, please. Thank you. So Lena, together with me, and Jeff Garver, please stand, Jeff. And Keith Helmuth, who can't be with us, but is an amazing and wonderful man from the Quaker Institute for the Future, were on the planning committee. And we also had good help from our co-sponsors, the Quaker Institute for the Future, the New Coalition, the New Economy Coalition, and the Philadelphia Area Cooperative Alliance. Caitlin, do you want to stand up and say hi now? Thank you, Caitlin Quigley. So these are our co-sponsors, and so we have a robust program for you of people who are local activists, big scale thinkers, and ordinary folks who are very concerned about the way the world is going and who have insights and thoughts to share. It's going to be a little bit of a different kind of a conference. So if you've come to the kind of conferences where you all sit, take notes, and then go home at the end of the day feeling greatly enriched, we hope that will be true here also. However, I think that we're in the state of democracy where we are exploring new and different ways of doing things. And you're going to find yourselves in some guinea pig situations where we're trying to learn from each other, not just from the so-called experts or the so-called activists, but from what we collectively have learned. So this is a sharing, learning community. To that end, we have put up two easels at least, and I think there may be more coming. One of which asks a question, something I know I want to discuss this weekend, so I want to have it discussed. I want it to be somewhere into the mix. And Lena and I are going to keep paying attention to that along with Jeff to make sure that that gets woven into the program. And on the other hand, also something I know, something that I can teach, or at least a conversation that I'm willing to bring together other people to talk about. So we're going to have more of an open forum, and we've called it an open fair, I think we've called it on a program. World Cafe, some of you are familiar with these terms, but it's more participatory than our traditional programs. So be prepared. It'll be fun. It'll be an experiment. It'll be something that you will learn about. Suppose you're going to be in a room with 8 people, maybe many of whom you don't even know, and you're going to be asked to do a task. And how do you show up in that environment? What are the gifts that you're bringing? What are you noticing about the way you're interacting with other people? All of these things are going to be important for us as we break out of our shells that we need to in order to be out there talking to people, listening to people. So we're looking forward to that. And my phone keeps going off. I wish I knew how I could do this without it having to need to get rejuiced all the time. Right now, however, I'd like to introduce you to Jeff Garver, who's going to read opening remarks that were written by Keith Helmuth. And Keith and a number of other folks, Ed Drebe and a couple of other people, formed the Quaker Institute for the Future with a regard for a moral economy that is going to both be respectful of all people, have a place for all people, welcome the gifts of all people, and also not be in conflict with the biosphere. Back in 2003, here at Pendle Hill, so this is somewhat of a homecoming for that organization. One of their key concerns is to bring this message to a wider audience, which they've done through their publications, which are available on the back table, but also wanting to engage people in the conversations with each other, not just reading books. So that's why we're here. And without eating a lot of time into other people, let me introduce Jeff Garver. Oh boy, this is going to be a challenge. Jeff is an adjunct professor on interdisciplinary studies on environmental and sustainability at McGill University and Concordia University. He is actively engaged in the economics of the Anthropocene Partnership, which has a website, for which he served as project coordinator from May 2013 to November 2015. Mr. Garver co-authored Right Relationship, Building a Whole Earth Economy in 2009. He was raised in a Quaker family in the countryside south of Buffalo, New York, and is a member of Montreal Monthly Meeting. And a fact that isn't included in here is he has recently finished his PhD dissertation. Yay! And Jeff is going to give you a few remarks, and then he is going to introduce our speaker for this evening. So thank you very much. Give Jeff a good welcome. Thank you, friend.
Thanks so much, John. It's a delight to be here on behalf of the Quaker Institute for the Future. There were to be two of us. I think I'm the only representative from our board. I know I'm the only representative of our board here. Keith Helmuth, unfortunately, couldn't be here, but he has given me some wonderful remarks to share. And so now I'm going to channel Keith. Wish I could turn into him. He's such a wonderful, wonderful person. So, from Keith. Greetings to you all from Quaker Institute for the Future, QIF. I had intended to deliver these brief background remarks in person, but circumstances have prevented me from being here. John Meyer invited QIF to be one of the conference co-sponsors, and over the last few months, Jeff Garver and I have consulted with him on behalf of the Institute. This opportunity is especially gratifying because it was at Pendle Hill in 2003 that QIF took shape and our focus on the moral economy began to emerge. During the latter part of his life, Kenneth Boulding developed a project he called Quaker Studies on Human Betterment. He convened a series of meetings for sharing research reports and to encourage further research on this theme by Quakers in the social sciences. The meetings were often held in conjunction with Friends Association for Higher Education. I was able to participate in two of them. That's Keith, not okay. When I came to Philadelphia in 1998, I made inquiries on whether this project had been carried on by the others after Kenneth Boulding's death. I found it had not. Considering the importance of Boulding's contributions to both economics and ecological thinking, and his effort to advance this thinking among friends, I figured this heritage should be actively continued. At the same time, it had become clear to the Environmental Working Group of Philadelphia yearly meeting that a fundamental conflict between economy, economics and ecology was at the heart of the environmental crisis. In order to generate deeper insight into this dilemma, Ed Drebe and I invited over 30 Quaker economists, ecologists, and public policy professionals to a weekend consultation at Pendle Hill in June 2003. Two projects emerged from this consultation. Friends Testimonies and Economics, or FTE, led by Ed Drebe, and Quaker Institute for the Future. Over the next 4 years, FTE produced a three-volume study guide on economics and ecology, Seeds of Violence, Seeds of Hope, which is now available on the Quaker EarthCare Witness website. QIF was founded at a subsequent meeting in August of 2003. A four-year moral economy project culminated in the publication of a flagship book, Right Relationship Building a Whole Earth Economy, and in a major symposium held in Montreal in 2009. The Institute began publishing QIF pamphlets in 2009 based on a series of research projects. The pamphlet series is now being called QIF Focus Books. 10 volumes have been published, and all of those books are available at the store here. Since 2003, a critical linkage has emerged which now sees that an economy based on the unlimited extraction and consumption of Earth's resources and the massive accumulation of wealth by a powerful elite is on the road to ecological ruin and corrosive societal regression. The social movement and ecological integrity movement have now converged into the eco-justice movement. QIF, likewise, has kept its focus on the way the economy often works against the well-being of people and the planet, and on the changes that are required to provide access to the means of life for all people and to protect Earth's ecosystems from ruinous damage. To have this focus return to Pendle Hill in this conference is indeed gratifying. The efforts of Friends are a small part of the larger eco-justice movement, and we need to continually revisit and renew our witness and our work. It's wonderful to have Pendle Hill picking up the task. In closing, I would like to call your attention to two documents that show the even deeper heritage of our efforts and which give me courage to keep insisting that the concern for a moral economy should be front and center in Friends' witness. In the midst of the Great Depression, Friends General Conference appointed a social economics committee to develop a Quaker response to the crisis. The three businessmen appointed were all professional engineers, and they presented a statement of economic objectives to FGG in session in July 1934. This remarkable document takes up the full scope of the circumstances of the Depression and in four pages provides analysis and remedy for the economic and social catastrophe of the time. It was not unusual for Quakers to be at the forefront of this kind of discernment. Friends were actively involved in the Roosevelt administration's New Deal recovery program. The second historic document comes from Friends Committee on National Legislation in 1969 and is titled Goals for a Just Society, Jobs, and Assured Income. This Quaker document remains a landmark synthesis of moral reasoning and economic policy proposals. It states, Friends Committee on National Legislation believes that a federal system of assuring income is morally right, necessary, and economically desirable. Given the regression in U.S. political life since 1969, this document may seem out of sync with the times. But that, to my mind, is all the more reason why we should study it thoroughly and carry its wisdom forward. Both documents are posted under the Queries and Thought Pieces link on the conference webpage. Thanks so much to John Meyer and others at Pendle Hill for organizing this event, and to you all for gathering here and carrying on this important work. And that's from Keith Helmuth. I hope, Keith, that you're listening. I hope he's tuned into the live stream, and suspect he is. And I'm going to give him a little nudge to continue sending insights to us as he's inspired to do so over the next couple of days. And if he does, I'll be sure to share them with you all. I just want to close here by just reading to you the vision and mission of Quiff. The board went through one of those exercises that organizations like that do to, you know, strategic planning and all those things. And those can be kind of a pain, really. But once the dust settles, I think you can come up with something that has some enduring sense. And I think we might have done that here. But I'll share those vision and mission with you. The vision of Quiff is that Quiff envisions a global future in which humanity is in right relationship with the commonwealth of life. And the mission of Quiff is to advance a global future of inclusion, social and economic justice, and ecological well-being through participatory research and discernment. It's been a few years since we wrote those, but they're still singing to me, and I hope they sing to you as well. And I'll close just with some personal insights. My father, Newton Garver, was the member of our family who brought us into the Quaker fold. But my involvement in writing Right Relationship and with Quiff has brought me back into the world of friends in a new way, on my own terms. It's no longer Dad's religion. And that experience of coming back into the fold of friends has been enriched many times through my participation in FGC gatherings and other events that have often highlighted in rich ways earth care and a moral economy. And having emerged now from the often lonely experience of finishing a PhD dissertation, I'm sure this conference will be another one of those rich experiences, and at this time, a really especially welcome one. So I'm very, very grateful to be here with you. And with that, let me introduce our speaker for tonight. I talked to Gar briefly, and he said he has a checkered past. I said, good! It's a pretty impressive checkered past. Gar was a Lionel R. Bauman professor of political economy at the University of Maryland from 1999 to 2015. He also was a fellow at King's College, Cambridge, and at the Harvard Institute of Politics, and a guest scholar at the Brookings Institution. He has experience in government. He worked in the legislative side in the U.S. House of Representatives and in the executive branch as a special assistant in the U.S. State Department. He's a co-founder of the Democracy Collaborative, and he's on the board of directors of the New Economics Institute. He's also quite a prolific author, and some of his notable works are America Beyond Capitalism, Reclaiming Our Wealth, Our Liberty, and Our Democracy, Unjust Deserts, How the Rich Are Taking Our Common Inheritance, and his most recent book published in 2013 is What Then Must We Do? Straight Talk About the Next American Revolution. I think this is a good person to be talking to us at this conference, so welcome, Gar.
I'm happy to talk without it, but I think they're recording it for...
Well, this would be unusual if we got off to a really good technological start.
You want me to use the other mic?
Maybe in a moment. Give me one second.
Yeah, didn't you turn? You turned it off before.
I turned it off. Sorry about that.
Yeah. Sounds good to me.
Okay.
Can we put this up here so the thing is exposed? Okay. It works a little bit better.
Is it not working?
Great.
Okay. Thank you. It always begins that way. I am really pleased to be with friends. I spent a great deal of time working both in the House and Senate with the Friends Committee on National Legislation, who were always ahead of the game and always productive and always very valuable friends of the progressive political process that I was involved in at the time. I also want to recognize an old friend of mine, Rabbi Arthur Waskow, 40-year friend who's a great leader and a great religious leader and a great political leader and a great historian. Some people don't know that. Welcome, Arthur. Thank you for coming. I want to disturb you. Kenneth Boulding, who I also knew, once said, and this is part of the discussion of the environment, anyone who thinks that the growth that we now have can go on forever is either a madman or an economist. Now, buried in the heart of that idea, and I'm going to stop right now to give you some websites because before I forget, www.democracycollaborative, www.thenextsystem, and www.community-wealth. Put the dash in, you won't get those are resources which will give you some ideas on the system project I'm going to talk about Democracy Collaborative on many, many economic projects that are going on around the country, and also the theory of all this is being developed. In any case, let me go back to the start here. I suspect many people sense that we actually live in a systemic crisis, not simply a political crisis. Now, people know that in some abstract way. What we don't do is follow the obvious consequences. If we face a systemic crisis, then the only answer to our problem is to change the system. Now, people know that. But that's such a gigantic idea. Who, me? Who, us? Who else? That question is not faced directly. It's kind of over there. We know about that, but let me do my project. I am very much for projects. But I also think that we need to face the system question. And indeed, what we're finding around the country, 10,000 people signed the statement that is in this book that's in the back of the room, which says, it's time to talk about the system crisis. We've had three presidents of the American Political Science Association, two of the American Sociological Association, one the president of the Academy of Management, arguing that we must explicitly talk to each other about this reality, and out of that confrontation with the reality, then to generate new directions forward. So that's what in the 1960s used to be called a heavy rap, an intense, big confront, because it means that we live in a system of gigantic corporations, of great wealth, a constitution that gives the 600 people in Wyoming the same votes in the Senate as the 34 million in California, and a military structure. Before I came in, I think you know that the president-elect has now put another Marine general as Secretary of Defense. A military structure that has created three wars in the post-war period in unconstitutional ways, the Korean War, the Vietnam War. I was in the Senate when the Gulf of Tonkin resolution was jammed through illegally, and the recent Iraq War. So we live in a system that is challenging to our whole idea about democracy. Now, I want to just say, I think people know something's wrong. And I think we're struggling with actually having to face that, because if we face a systemic problem, and if we want to go beyond rhetoric, then two questions become obvious. Is there a systemic design that you would want to live with and could achieve the values of equality, liberty, democracy, ecological sustainability, peace? Heavy values, very important. Is there a systemic design that would actually produce those outcomes? So that's a real, that's an intellectual question. It's a serious question. It's like the question those people who designed the American Constitution actually struggled with, and they did do that. People can struggle with those questions, like us. They were no different. So that's the first question. Supposing you actually knew there was a new direction, and the Next System Project is attempting, if you go to these websites, you'll find a huge debate about if you don't like corporate capitalism, you don't like state socialism, is there a design? 36 papers have been written. We've had two conferences, one at Harvard, one at MIT. There's a big, big academic involvement with this. It is a real question that people can struggle with, just as people struggled with the creation of the Constitution. No different. They were people like us. I'm talking to the person sitting in your seat and mine. So to put it another way, the system problem is not a problem of academic difficulty. It's a problem of existential concern. It's about us, not about the system in some fundamental sense, whether we're up to the question. So there is a whole debate going on. If you don't like corporate capitalism, you don't like state socialism, what do you want? And I think there are a lot of answers. I'll give you some that I'm concerned with and some of my own views of that in a few minutes. The second question is, supposing you actually had clarified for yourself and with your friends what it is you thought was a proper direction that would achieve equality, liberty, ecological sustainability, community, and peace. Those are really big ones. Suppose you had convinced yourself of a design, like the committees of correspondence worked it through, like the people who wrote the Constitution worked it through and got a design that might meet Ken Boulding's criteria and perhaps others. And the second question you have to ask yourself is, how do we get from here to there? Is that a utopian, radical, crazy question? Or is it a possibility that actually people like us can contribute to and commit to in an intelligent, rational, serious way and change the system? Or lay groundwork for, and this is how I think about it, lay groundwork for an irreversible transformation. We may not get to the promised land, but we may establish the conditions. But we might get there. We may establish the conditions which make the trajectory irreversible. So those are two heavy questions. I'll let them sit in your lap there, kind of look at them for a while. And I'll tell you about some of the things that we've been seeing happening around the country. The number of people that are moving from projects in communities of important scale to larger projects of even more important scale begin to give you a sense of stepping stones. And they're really important because there are lots of small cooperatives. The most basic unit of community transformation and socializing capital. I used an unfortunate word. A co-op socializes capital. It is a collective form of ownership. So does a municipal utility. 25% of American electricity is now provided by socialist institutions, utilities and co-ops. But those are micro institutions that we live with that suggest possibilities of a more democratic form of owning the economy, piece by piece. They are, however, co-ops in particular, small scale. And I want to give an evaluation of the co-op movement that is both very positive and also a certain historical perspective. I think it's critical to develop serious worker-owned co-ops and other forms of co-ops. It is also a fact that they have not yet in any country advanced beyond 4 or 5% of the workforce. That's just a fact. So it may be that there is a trajectory that can take co-ops to system change rather than to elements in the new system, but there's a lot of rhetoric that needs to be confronted with the reality. So for instance, the famous Mondragon Corporation, which we have a lot, our group did a lot of work with, is 4% of the labor force, not of Spain, but of the region in which it lives. And about half of those are employees, not co-op owners. 1% of the population is in co-ops in all of Spain. So you need to say if maybe co-ops are the answer, or they're a piece of the answer, but if you want to change the system, one needs to understand and think about and actually learn the direction and possibility of these very, very positive things that need doing. Don't misunderstand me. I am very much a fan of the development of more co-ops, and they're not the full answer. In the other great experiments, for some of you who know about this history, is the Emilia-Romagna region of sort of the red belt of Italy, where there's explosion over the last 40 years of worker co-ops. 10%. Half of which, again, are employees of the co-ops. And in some cases have a co-op of 300 people owns several corporations. And you have to pay $300,000 to become a member. So the history is not, it's very important to get the history right. There's a lot of very positive things going on with co-ops. But I'm challenging this because it's a current nostrum in some parts of the country that this is the answer. I think it is a piece of the answer. If you begin to ask questions about how could we do anything at this level of a continent, I mean, it's a very big country. Montana is bigger than Germany. I mean, we don't really realize how big the scale is. But if you ask how could we do anything, you know, California is the sixth largest economy in the world. But even Montana, you get the perspective. If you ask about, well, what about those big corporations at the center? That's where all the power is. Are you talking about socializing those entities? I mean, making democratic ownership? And why would you want to do that? Well, for one thing, and we'll get to the practicalities, they have to grow. You all know that. They have to get their financing at Wall Street, and they cannot get it unless they have a growing profit all the time. Corporate capitalist institutions have to grow contrary to the need to reduce growth for ecological reasons. That is their nature. Problem, because the only other model we know about is to socialize them. And we've had some experience with the bureaucracies and terrorism that comes from concentrating power in the Soviet Union. So those socialist models that we know about do not offer very good answers. So that puts another big question on the table. I'll give you some of the thinking that we've been developing and other people have been developing about that. But it's very important to note, if you're interested in the environment, they have to grow. Now, when I worked in the Senate, I worked both the House and Senate, I was legislative director to a guy named Gaylord Nelson. Name mean anything to you?
Yes.
Founder of the Earth Day, great environmentalist. In those days, it was possible to actually achieve significant regulation of environmental regulation, Clean Water Act, the Clean Air Act, and several others in the late 60s, right up to the middle of the 70s. Now, what that was about was a particular, I'm going to introduce the term, systemic design that had a political economic valence that allowed you to do that. And I know we're going to have a talk later on about social democracy, the Scandinavian countries, which was that design. So here's the system design that made that possible when I worked in the Senate long ago. Gaylord was a labor lawyer and a great environmentalist. there was sufficient power in the labor movement with the environmentalists to empower an environmental caucus that could actually regulate the corporations. People don't realize that because often environmentalists and labor fought, but together they could produce people like Gaylord Nelson and all of the legislation that occurred in that period. That's the Scandinavian model. Let the corporations have the capital, let them do what you can, but regulate them. It depended upon having that nexus. Now, the problem is, in all of these countries, including Scandinavia, the institutional power base of that nexus was organized labor. At that point, something like 34% of the labor force was in unions. And together you could eke out a control. You could also get some minimum wage. You could get some social programs. At that point, we got the anti-poverty programs, Medicare, Medicaid. All of that came from that nexus at that point in time. Labor has gone from 34. We were never a strong labor country. I mean, the Swedes were at 85% of the labor force in unions. That was power. We peaked at 34.5% in 1953. Still, it was enough. Labor has gone from that 34.5 watermark. It's down now to 11% of the labor force, 6% in the private sector, and going down further. So now let me turn it to systemic design. The systemic design that allowed large corporations to control capital and the market, controlled and managed and hedged in and made it reformed by that nexus, somewhat in the United States, weaker here than in any of the other advanced countries, great in Sweden, but now failing, that whole design is over. That horse will not ride again. Sadly, I'm a great proponent of the American labor movement, but that's a systemic design that many people implicitly think will ride again. And my suggestion to you is that's over. So now you're facing large corporations doing what the current president-elect of the United States has done, Wall Street and every major part, place he can put them in the cabinet and generals elsewhere, and no significant strength to combat it. But I want to bring it to the, again, back to the systemic design. What we had is no longer and not likely to rise again. Very few people think that we can get that nexus of the organized labor movement. So now, if you don't like state socialism, because it concentrates power, and you don't like corporate capitalism for the reasons, many other reasons, because it concentrates power, it destroys the environment, among other things, and this one is particularly important to those of you who care about community, as I do, it disrupts community in many different ways. Most importantly, I'm from Racine, Wisconsin, the corporations move and the cities go down. I worked with steel workers in Youngstown, Ohio, 140,000, now down to 40,000. Bam. Cleveland, 900,000, less than 400,000. Detroit, over 1 million people lost. By the way, where did the people go? Nobody cares. But the point is that corporations have the capacity in our system to move out and undermine the very thing that many people in this room care as critical, the rebuilding of a moral community. And we can't manage them. You're up against a system problem. And so ultimately some design. This is not magic. What is the nature of a design that could achieve sustainable capacity to manage communities in which you could build a moral context? Those are hard problems, but they're not beyond thought and action. I'm trying to pose how much we are at the level of the American constitutional era. I think the period we are entering, I don't want to scare you, is of the same nature of power and question of the period, even more than the constitutional era, that we are facing a genuine systemic crisis, not a political crisis. We have a political crisis too. But more important is that the underlying institutional architecture is producing the outcomes you see, and the alternative out design, state socialism, doesn't work. in the way you went. So that my suggestion to you is where we're at. And what we're finding is that people know that. And they don't say it, they don't articulate it, they don't have a whole theory of it, but there's a strong sense that the problem is deeper than politics and deeper than community and deeper than co-ops and much deeper at every different level you want to go to. So what we're really talking about is opening up and saying what everybody knows, or senses, more likely senses. And then beginning to say, how do we actually begin to say, how would we actually think about designing a different system? Just like the constitutional question, if you like, a little bit heavier, I think, but it's of that order. And if that's so, I'm making light of it, but obviously they're very heavy questions. How might we get from here to there without a bloody revolution, without the horror of what could happen? Is there a transformative path? And how do we apply human intelligence and ingenuity to that question? Ordinarily, and thinking about it like practical, like how would we do it? As in, how could I build that table if I really knew how to be a carpenter? It's of that order. That is what makes sense. So that's the broad question. And what we're also finding is people are beginning to experiment. And a sense of historical process that allows for experimentation, not simply for experimentation purposes, but with a view to understanding that what we now have might be a stepping stone to what the next, and maybe we will learn beyond that from here, like that. To learn more and to actually think about it and see yourself, here's the hard part, I'm talking to the person in your chair, to see yourself as the person who is actually doing that, rather than just doing this project. But no, trying to build the basis of knowledge and politics and organization, experience, ideas, theory, movement building, that has the goal of transforming the system in an intelligent way that would deal with some of the problems we know all the other systems have screwed up. So that's the existential part. That's the really hard part. You look in the mirror tomorrow and say, who, me? I'm serious. That's the existential question. This is not beyond human nature. People do revolutions all the time in history. But a peaceful developmental transformation of this kind, that means it's all about, has nothing to do with any of the design problems. It has to do existentially if we actually, you and I, are up to it. Because if we're up to it, we will actually figure out how to do this. That's our bet. So let me back off and give you a couple of pieces of what information. We're finding lots of people beginning to get into this discussion. We've published now on our website, I think it's 26 different designs, very sophisticated designs of how you might organize something like an advanced post-industrial system. Some of them emphasize communities. Some of them are very strong on environment. My co-chair in this next system project is a guy named Gus Speth. People know James Gustav Speth, very well-known environmentalist, was environmental advisor to President Carter and dean of the Environment School of Forestry at Yale. So Gus, but we're finding, Bill McKibben is part of this, we're finding people who are beginning to come in at the environmental level. How do you come in at this from an environmental perspective? We're finding people come in from a racial perspective. How do you come in at that? And beginning to, and not just raise the question from those perspectives, but asking how do you do a system? How do you actually do that? Now, one of the things, we're also seeing a progression, and I think this is pretty obvious, nothing fancy here, that there are 26 different discussions. There's a whole discussion going on the website. There's really interesting work being done on these design questions, so you can get into it if you want to, just go to that website. But we're also finding a progression in transformative institutional development. And that's what excites me. So I begin with the premise that the wealth ought to belong to the people. In that sense, I'm a socialist. And I think that private ownership of large scale, I have no problem with small scale private ownership and small scale co-ops. But significant scale wealth, I believe, has such power attached to it that it ought to be, in some sense, organized democratically. The problem is in the words, in some sense, because we know something about the power that attaches to social institutions and bureaucracies. But we're seeing experimentation. And that's what's interesting. So, for instance, there are lots of co-ops being developed. Worker-owned co-ops are hot. However, there are only less than 500 have actually succeeded in the United States. Very, very small numbers actually succeeded. But people like that. There's a kind of romance about it right now. But that's important. We're also seeing experimentation. How many know about Evergreen in Cleveland, the Evergreen Project? Okay, the Evergreen Project is a scaled-up model, which our group had something to do with, and it's an experimental model. But the importance of the model in terms of design, and I want to get that word out here. Think of design rather than abstract rhetoric about changing the system. It's a design problem. It's also a political problem. So what's interesting about the design of the Cleveland Project is it is a design aimed at community first. So it's in an area of 40,000 person neighborhood and a nonprofit corporation which includes the whole neighborhood is the central institution to which are subordinated and attached worker-owned co-ops. So they're part of a complex, but the principle is community, not worker-owned co-ops. That's the central guiding idea of it. And there are many problems with the Cleveland model, but in fact, it's 150 people are working in these three major co-ops now. One is a very, very ecologically well-developed laundry. There's a solar installation operation, and then there's a huge greenhouse, the largest one in the Midwest, capable of producing 3 million heads of lettuce a year. So scale is important. So if you've got a model, look at the design, and then you can play with another design. It's community-wide with community representatives, and I think the next stage, much better democratization of the representation. We could get into that if you'd like. And subordinating and integrating co-ops. And neighborhood structures are also part of this as well. So it's somewhat complex, almost like the craziness of the US Constitution, which has a very odd design with federalism and states and localities and et cetera. More important than that, and this is one design, to stabilize the market, and this is a design problem, there is an economic planning system. Now, we don't call it that. It is public institutions, universities and hospitals in particular, have a lot of public money, using that public money to purchase from and stabilize and guard from the market this community-enhancing decentralized structure, which includes complexity of worker co-ops and community as the central principle, but stabilized by a planning system. Now, if you wanted to kind of take that national, it's, you know, we did nationalize General Motors and Chrysler. We did do that, and the public government owned that, and that could have been transformed into a mass transit and high-speed rail producing system. And then you would have had contracts to give to people to make those equipment, and they could have been community, worker-owned, you got the picture. So these principles are being explored. By the way, we did nationalize those industries. Crises do happen, plus about five banks, although they didn't call it that. I mean, the banks were actually basically taken over, but not in exactly that precise form. So those of you who think about how do you ever get to the big ones, that just happened a couple of years ago, and there was no movement able to transform it into something positive. And so it went back to what you got. So it isn't just small scale, and that's part of what I want to talk to you about. It isn't necessarily only small co-ops. If you're willing to rise to the Constitution founding fathers and mothers level, we nationalize them, and there will be future crises. The question is, if we knew what to do with them and had built a politics that was actually thoughtful and intelligent and really had worked through, and that doesn't work, we had to do it this way and had it really worked it through, we might actually begin not just to do co-ops and not just to do community, but to think about big stuff. Because if you don't, they will continue to grow and destroy and do what they do. So, let me give you another piece of that puzzle. I mentioned that we're seeing things grow and expand around the country. That website I gave you, community-wealth, has got a compendium of expansive stuff I understand you're about to maybe set up a city-owned bank in Philadelphia, or at least there's a movement here, and I suspect can be taken forward. Some friends of mine who are involved with that, we've been involved with the public banking movement. There's a public banking movement happening all over the country, too. Santa Fe is the furthest along. Philadelphia and Denver are the next in line. The Bank of North Dakota, as many people know, has been standing there for 100 years. It was created by basically labor-farmer coalition, kind of a socialist, about 100 years ago. But the notion that there can be public banks is growing. One of the papers I read for this conference is also there's a huge development going on in monetary theory. How many know been following monetary theory? There you go. It has dawned on Bernie Sanders, chief economist, is one of the leaders of this, but this is a worldwide movement. It's dawned on people that money is created out of nothing. You knew that, didn't you? There's no little pot of money, because if there weren't more money created out of nothing, the economy would never grow. Somebody's got to create it. The banks create it when they make a loan to you out of their deposits. Or the federal government can do that. And once you see that, and that's the monetary theory revolution is going on too. So there are a lot of interesting things going on. Once you see that, you can see there is absolutely no reason that you couldn't do almost all the economic things that we want to do in this country, infrastructure, housing, healthcare, et cetera. Just spend the money, put people to work, and you would actually make it happen. Now that sounds really weird if you don't know monetary theory. But let me tell you how I can give you another way to understand it. My aunt Isabel, may she rest in peace, ran a little bakery store in Racine, Wisconsin, where I'm from. And she put it to me this way, you know, I lived in the Depression. There wasn't a lot of money around. And then they had a war, and there was all kinds of money around. Oh yeah, it can be done when you want to do it. And that's what modern monetary theory is basically elaborating. It's a very sophisticated thing going on all over the world now. That this whole idea, the myths around monetary policy are beginning to collapse. So that's another piece of the puzzle. Another piece of the puzzle that's opening up slowly. So I am not a utopian optimist. It is possible there is no solution to this problem. Rome did decay. Violence and dictatorships are possible. Chile went through Pinochet. We may go through a very hard time, and we may or may not come out the other end. And I'm making light about this just to kind of open this up to you. This is very heavy stuff. But I'm trying to urge you that it is within the possibility of every person in this room to ask in the mirror in the morning, am I up to thinking about contributing to changing the system, or am I just doing my project? You do need to do your project. But are we opening study groups are big important. I mean, my heroes are the women in the 1960s who would, they ask, where does power come from? You get a half a dozen women together, you get some drinks or Cokes or water or better than that. You get some pizza, you read and learn something together, you reinforce each other, you think about it, then you support each other, and you act locally. That's where power comes from. They knew that. That's how you change systems. So I'm a historian. That's how it goes. That's how it really goes. People do that. So I'm making light of this, but I'm suggesting to you in all this lightness that we actually face that problem, and that's what you can do. And that a lot of other people are beginning to cop to this possibility. Slowly, particularly in the environmental community, beginning to get it. The black community understands something big is going on. It's not going to be an easy turn. It's something taking over and dealing with what's going on in the communities is going to be very important in a very different way. And what's happening in Washington is going to remind us again and again and again that unless we change the system some way, and the old option of liberal reform is not going to be there, that's where we are. That's where we are. At least that's how I think about it. So let me take it one more step to you, because I want to bring one of the hardest problems to you, because I've just only given you some of the easy ones so far. Look, I'm going to oversimplify this, and my good friend Arthur, who's a better historian than I am, will kind of look me in the face when I say it, but anyway. The way the elites ran the system in the 19th century, radically oversimplified, is that if there are any real problems, they just took more land and took it away from the natives until they got to the end. This is a variation of what was called the frontier thesis. They ran out of land. In the 20th century, and I'm not saying this is by design, I'm going to be very clear about that. In the first quarter of the century, there were major, major recessions, bank crises, et cetera, and World War I bailed out the system. Not by design, in my view. It happened that way. And then in the 20s, if you look carefully, particularly in the agricultural sector, some of the problems that were building up, and also in the finance sector, produced the Great Depression. And in 1937, there was a boom, and in 1937, difficulties resumed, and in the second quarter of the century, World War II bailed out the system. In the third quarter of the century, Korea, Vietnam, Iraq, and Iran, and the system has been stabilized. Military budget's only less than 4% of the GDP now. You didn't know that, I'll bet. It's very large, but it's a very small percentage of the GDP, not enough to stabilize the system, and declining as a percentage of GDP. Now, the new president may boost it up a little bit, but it's within a much narrower range than the 13%. And so it doesn't, this is a very big economy. So the K you see, which is neither a collapse nor a boom, but stagnation with ripples of decay, that's a really different historical phenomenon from either post-war boom or the collapse. It's a period that doesn't collapse and doesn't succeed, doesn't collapse, doesn't succeed, in my view, sporadic difficulties. But what it does create is disillusionment. And that's important. People sense something's wrong. And there's a good reason for that. That's the time when people who are serious about what can happen and have clarity about it and can begin to offer a direction and a longer-term process and a vision and some ideas and projects you can do, just possibly, I'm going to say this carefully, just possibly can lay the irreversible irreversible foundations. I'm going to say it carefully. Just possibly we can, I am talking to the person in your chair, we can lay down the irreversible foundations for a longer transformation. I don't think we're going to get to the Holy Land. I certainly am not. But I do think we can make that contribution and just possibly establish that basis. And it takes personally looking at how are we doing projects and then thinking how do we scale. And then also thinking about politics in a different way and vision and actually being foolish enough to say to somebody, what are you doing? I'm changing the system. What? But actually thinking existentially that way. So I don't think we have a political economic system problem. I've just spent three quarters of an hour or half hour telling you we did. I don't think that's where the problem is. I think it's with us. It's an existential question. Are we up to that challenge? Who, me? The most powerful corporate capitalist system in the history of the world? Are you kidding me? No. That's the challenge. When you look in the mirror in the morning, there is knowledge, there's a debate, there are projects, there's experience, there's a lot to learn, there's a lot to do, and every year somebody does something bigger around the country to build on. That's the process that I think is beginning. In the midst of this pain, in the midst of this new government, in the midst of the violence we're bound to see, going to and through that process. Some people, I like to remind people, because they always, this question always comes up. They're going to repress you. Maybe so. Chile has gone through Pinochet. Many countries have gone through, and that's a possibility. Whether or not you want to change the system, by the way, whether or not, probably more if you don't, because the despair and unrest and violence that we're likely to see out of lack of hope is probably going to be more repressed than if we offer a positive direction to build. But I want to suggest to you that this generation and us actually in, and it needs to be ordinary talk, not fancy talk. This generation actually has the possibility, because I think they have run out of options. And if they don't blow us up, which is also a possibility, I'm a historian of nuclear weapons in my spare time. And that's the biggie. If they don't blow us up, I think we have the possibility of establishing the basis of a transformative vision and a transformative system. And I think of no other place than with people like friends here that where that kind of process can be enhanced and developed and given a new moral basis along the basis in the teachings of the Friends and the Quakers of America and around the world. So thank you very much. There may be questions or two. Like, did you want us to do some questions?
Yes.
I hope I've raised a couple questions.
I should think so.
I hope so. Oh, thank you.
Friends. Okay. Friends. There we go. In deference to the people who are viewing this live at home or with others in their community, if you would wait to be called on by Gar, I will run around with the microphone. And if you would hold the microphone, you see where we're doing it? Right up here, right below your lip. That'll avoid spitting, but you'll be heard by everybody, including the people at home. When you start to wave it around and like that, you don't get to. So don't gesticulate, just hold it. Ask your question or your comment if you would stand. Identify your name so that we begin to know who's in the room. That will also help us to know each other. So I'm going to ask Gar to call on folks. And I knew O would be right there at the top. Thank you, dear.
Thank you for your talk. My name is O. I have a statement and a question. My statement is, women of color have always known there is a problem. We have always known. Mm-hmm. So I have a lot of frustration at that level. Given that, often people of color do have solution, and we are not listened to. We do believe that it is up to us, but obviously it can only be up to us in collaboration. We need each other. But often my personal experience has been that when I attempt to share the story of my heart, I am seen as it's impossible. I meet cynical and resigned is what I meet. And I'm heartbroken by that, because I agree with you that it is an existential situation, that it is up to us, but how do we do the us crossing over racial lines, educational lines especially, superior and inferior? How do we interrupt the very structures that create us and them with us?
Well, we have some opportunity maybe to experiment for the next 2 days, but I think it's, I hear you entirely. A good friend of mine is a woman named Jessica Gordon Nemhart. People know Jessica's name and her work? Jessica, I brought Jessica to the University of Maryland, got her as associate professor. When I first met her, I grabbed her, she's a black economist. I said, black woman economist interested in co-ops, which is what she's interested in. She had 14 years of hard work on a book that you must read. I suggest it's on the development over time against extraordinary odds of black common development. Again, mostly by women, by the way. One of her findings, mostly by women. Do you know how hard it is to dig up that research in church basements and so on? It's an extraordinary book. But also it's an extraordinary demonstration by Jessica herself of what it takes, which is hanging in against the odds when it's really tough. Now, I don't have a better answer to you than that's our challenge, but I think that is the truth.
What's the name of the book?
What is the name of the book?
Courage.
What is it?
Collective
Courage, yeah. It's an extraordinary book because
the title of the book is Collective Courage, and I looked it up the other day. It's kind of pricey, to be honest, but that's always with a good book.
and a good cause. But what it tells you about is how, and now there's, and it's given a lot of people hope. If they could do it in against the odds they faced. Anyway, I don't have anything better to offer. What I might add is, you know, revolutions are as common as grass in world history. And in every one of them, it's like what you talked about at the beginning. That's the way it is. Yeah.
Yes, I'd like to also say thank you for your talk. I've been actually following you a little on the internet, so I'm familiar with some of your ideas. One of the things you mentioned was, or words that I heard, was disillusionment, despair. And I guess what I'm thinking is that there's a lot of, I don't know if I mentioned my name. Did I forget to say that?
Yeah.
My name's Roger Paulson. But there is a lot of that and contributing to the apathy that exists. And I think that's one of the great obstacles that we have faced and we are facing. Also, I find that when, you know, any kind of project is begun, people have a lot of enthusiasm for it, and then it kind of fizzles. And I guess the real question is, how do you maintain that kind of enthusiasm? How do you prevent despair from setting in? If you look at anything that in human history where anything has been accomplished, it's usually done so with a great deal of enthusiasm and a great deal of, you know, spirit. And the other thing is, how do you keep people involved and how do you keep them engaged? Because I have tried various things over the years, different kinds of activities and crusades and so forth. And I find, again, that people tend to drop off and they lose their own sense of their importance or their sense of, you know, what they can really contribute. And I guess that's really one of the big obstacles. That's one of the big challenges, I think, that we're really facing here. And I just thought that maybe you could have some more to say about that.
I don't have any magic. I think that what happens is people hang in as best they can. And sometimes it's the wrong time. And then another group hangs in, and sometimes it's the right time. But I do know that unless you engage, you know, when I was at the University of Wisconsin, we had a great professor, William Edmund Williams, and he, one of his great mottos was from Napoleon. He was a radical. He was a radical historian, but Napoleon was no radical. And in French, it's on s'engage et puis on voit. One engages, and then you see. You don't see until you engage. So that's I mean, I think that's the problem. We don't know the timing. But I also give you another piece of history from Wisconsin, Wisconsin lore. So I'm a little older than I look. And so I went to school in grade school and also university in the 1950s in Wisconsin. Now, Joe McCarthy was a senator from Wisconsin at that time. And as they said, he shot anything that moved politically. Anything that moved politically. My high school teachers were like that they would say the wrong thing, literally. They were scared because McCarthy was scared everybody in the country. But in Wisconsin, in the late 1950s, it was, I mean, and if you had said, oh, this kind of things I'm talking about, right? Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? And then the 1960s happened. Totally out of not predicted. So it's hard to know when the time is, but also I wouldn't neglect the people who work in the times when it isn't there. So my heroes, and I really mean this, are the civil rights workers in Mississippi in the 1930s. That's when the real work was done. Laying the groundwork against all the odds for what became the 60s. Easy to join a movement when a movement's moving. Hard to do it when it's not moving and laying the groundwork. So, engage. Sir.
My name is Dan Bailiff, and also thank you, Gar, for coming. It's really great to see you. I don't really have a question per se, but some of the things that fascinate me about the human experience is the way in which we engage with our words to describe what it is that we're actually doing, and how complex those understandings are. But if we dissect them in different ways, we might be able to see a sense of hope where one wouldn't necessarily be looking for it. So in relationship to disillusionment, what I would say is that we're perhaps living in a period of illusion, because the reality of what this doctrine of domination that we have benefited from might describe is actually a false rule. It was created out of nothing, like money. So we need to dissemble the illusion that we have power by virtue of our being here. It's because of what we do that gives us power. And in that light, the conditions that we're living in are quite unique. And I would say this in a metaphorical way, but it's quite real. The internet, which I spent a lot of time helping Comcast to build, is actually a web of light. The words and the thoughts are extended to us in packets that ride a light beam. And light, in the metaphorical sense, in every teaching, in every story I've ever read, is the source of knowledge and insight and hope. This web of light brought down the Egyptian government of Mubarak that had been in place for 40 years in 2 weeks. I mean, they had difficulties because they never experienced anything like that before, and they weren't able to keep it going. But in reality, Facebook and social media did that. Those conditions did not exist in the period of Pinochet. We have a power of light at our fingertips that can instantaneously connect us with every person on the planet. This, in my view, is like the fulfillment of the oneness of humanity. It's here. It's at our fingertips, and we can take advantage of it. And the stories tell us that it is part of the visionary experience. The prophets talked about it. And though you may or may not believe in infinite essence or the one God, but the reality is that we have these stories embedded in our culture. And if we're able to, you know, take apart the conditions of our illusion that we don't have this power, then we can actually acknowledge that it is ours. And that is what gives us the strength to move forward. Essentially, the women of color use their faith to draw on and to come together. Now, I mean, this room is mostly white, and we have a lot of responsibility that we have to take. We're not to blame, I don't think, for, you know, the people sitting in this room for what's going on with the Ramapo and the indigenous people and the poverty in the black communities, but we are needing to take some responsibility for it. And standing up to that, I think there's a lot of power there.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Right here. I want to do mention one other thing I usually mention, but just so I want to drop this into the environment. If you give me, it's going to be only two seconds. Don't trust me if I say it 2 seconds. It's probably going to be one. I just want to drop this little fact that the United States, if you broke up the income of the United States today equally, if everybody got the same share, every family of four would have $240,000 now. Did you know how rich this country is? It will increase about six to seven fold over the next century, so that the woman at 100 years from now, the number will be over a million for every family of four, or a 20-hour week, a 10-hour week. It's a very rich country. There's a lot of space in the economy. Sorry.
My name is Patricia Finley. Patricia Finley. I was interested in what you said about laying the foundation for future transformation. And I've been noticing changes in assumptions lately. Like about 8 years ago, people started talking about banks too big to fail. That's kind of radical. But people are starting to accept it as normal. And I'm thinking that part of what you were saying is that corporations are so big they can make cities fail. Mm-hmm. Nobody's thinking of that as abnormal or wrong, but maybe they should start thinking that. That's where frames of reference might be changed. Frames of reference might be changed, and transformation might emerge.
A friend of mine would say, I like the cut of your jib. Arthur. Reb Waska.
Thank you. So, welcome and thank you. I've been fascinated by the response around the country to Standing Rock, North Dakota, where it seems to me, and what I want was your sense of that, it seems to me this has become a profoundly spiritual, not only new system, not only protecting the planet from the oil, from the poisoning the water, but lifting up an entirely different way of relating to the earth and to each other. And it sparked all over the place now. My memory, like yours, goes back long enough to remember how the television reports from Birmingham, Alabama, and Bull Connor, but the heart of that was a religious response. Mm-hmm. And it was a new notion of what American Christianity really could be. So I'm wondering, at what level is the system that you've been talking about, mostly in economic, institutional sense, at what level is that also a spiritual crisis, and how do we respond to that?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for that both question and assessment. For me, the issue is community. And that's a powerful theme in most religious and spiritual concerns, and certainly among friends and Quakers. And the problem has been it didn't take an institutional form with seriousness. It maintained the spiritual, Caesar and others. And when and if the spiritual concern of what a meaningful community actually is and what its systemic requirements are, rather than over here is spiritual community, over here is the system, when that happens, and maybe you're right, it may be beginning to show, I hope so, that's when we get some real change. That's the real question. It hasn't happened. It's kind of, we've had civil rights, the religious community stood up. I worked with the Catholic bishops on their 1985 pastoral. We got a new pope now, but the pope then came by and went to Canada and he said, go further to the left, guys. Go further. So it was quite a progressive, liberal, social democratic pastoral. 10 years later, you couldn't get the bishops to talk about it. Catholic Church, we've got a new Pope who's got this issue. He understands the relationship between institutions and structure and systems and the religious vision. If that can be done, and when, or let me put it this way, when that is done, then there's really power in that. At the moment, I'm urging this, the institutional parts, because I think it's always been neglected and it's time to start talking about it. But, and let me put it the negative. If it's only community in a spiritual sense, it doesn't deal with institutions, count me out. Because it's not going to produce the outcome values. And that's the nexus. If we can put sophisticated thinking about what it means to build a different system and the vision of community that has depth and spiritual concern, that's where power comes from. Now, I beg you, those of you who are deeply involved in any religious community, including this one, that issue needs to be opened up, and we have not seen it open up in the churches. I mean, there are exceptions around the edge. And there is concern, but not to this go to the heart of the system question. Are you talking about capitalism? Yeah. You're talking about state socialism? Yeah, we don't want that either. You're talking about changing the system? Yeah. That's not happening. They're scared to death of it. No, that's not entirely true. They don't even know that's the question very often. So that's where, if that thing happens, and maybe this Mr. Trump is going to give us something to force the churches into waking up a little bit, then we're talking about a different thing. I agree with you entirely. Thank you for that. Yep.
I think that
comment
was up for me.
Were you up? I was trying to go back and forth. You're next. You're up next.
Hi, my name is Donna Cassano, and I'm here representing Transition Town Media and Time Banking. We had a wonderful discussion at dinner about similar things that we're talking about right now, and especially about these bringing a sense of sacredness to new economies. And what came up from that discussion was the fact that some people's needs aren't getting met. I mean, it is just a basic fact. And some people don't feel safe within this economy or within even discussions about changing the economy. And I'm wondering what response you might have about bringing a sense of safety to the discussions. Do I feel like I can be vulnerable in a discussion when there's someone on the other side of the room whose needs are clearly being met on an economic level and my needs are not being met? How do I get heard?
So. You all know the answer to that. There's a line in Conrad, with the motion of your hands and feet you keep afloat. There's no easy answer. They're a bitch. No, I'm saying that it is existential, that going through the hard places. For me, I'm an old liberal. I've become a radical. I didn't like that idea. Who, me? I don't want to talk about any of this stuff that I'm talking about tonight. It's uncomfortable in lots of circles. Are you talking? Yes, that's what I'm talking. Changes. There's nothing to do but push through the hard places, maybe with a little support from your friends holding hands. But I really want to underline what you're saying. It's an existential problem. The system problem is an existential problem. Can we step up to it, including in the way you're talking about? I don't have an easy answer. It's a bitch. Sir.
While I'm walking, I'm going to make a comment, because I think that there's a great fear that is part of what capitalism wants everybody to be very nervous about where their place is in the world. And that fear isolates and atomizes. It's not only good for consumerism, it's good for keeping people in their place.
Absolutely.
And not rocking the boat, because you feel like you're just one rung above falling down. And that's increased. And if love is the one thing that casts out fear, then really what Arthur was talking about, it's not just an existential question, which it is, but it's a deep-seated human spiritual question of what is our relationship with each other, that if we appeal to that as we approach our colleagues and let them admit that fear is really a huge motivator in both of our lives. And why is that? Why should that be the case?
Peace, everybody. My name is Terrence. I do some work right in Chester, the community next door to here. Everybody's talking about this spiritual thing. I'll just come back from Wisconsin visiting Will Allen and Growing Power, and I met a gentleman out there, and the entire weekend I was spent with him, and just really opening me up to this spiritual divine intervention. And just want to touch on a couple points that the people have said, and I don't know that I have a question. I think a question will come, but what O was saying about how just breaking down these walls of just like this codependence that the system has developed and perpetuates in the Black community, and this sense of non-ability of for the powers that be to allow Black people to have resources and work with autonomy, right? So it's this whole idea, like this reductionist view of like research and science, how we do papers on biocontrol, and we do stuff in laboratories, and we're not doing stuff outside, and the whole idea of systems-based research, and this whole idea of separation of church and state, how industry and politics get separated from that spiritual piece, it allows us to get away from the morality of our behavior. And I think like just the design of this economic system, the design of our spiritual system, we're talking about we got to get this church in churches in Chester. I mean, I don't want to speak bad, but I mean, there's more that can be done. I mean, the separation from that spiritual piece in terms of what we do in the community with those churches are contributing to the community, what they receive from that, the people and the denominations that are received. And just how we just got to connect it. I think like just this weekend, I think this is going to just continue to be a discussion. And you're talking about this existentialism, and that's really what it comes down to. How do we be better people? How do we really, really figure this out? And so with this reductionist vibration, I think my question was, what practical approaches, what practical strategies are there to invoke this spiritual conversation, invoke this spiritual piece, and how do we tie this spiritual piece in with the economic piece, with the social piece, with this environmental piece? And I think I work on an urban farm, and I just want to build gardens everywhere. I feel like my experience in spending time with the land, I feel like I'm closest to God at that point, with my hands in the ground, when I'm working with the youth and sharing that with them, and to see the God in them when they become interested in that piece. I don't want to say that there's like a silver bullet or anything, but I think that's one of the pieces, that cooperative piece is one of the pieces. Like, I think this weekend I hope that we can discuss all the pieces that everybody is doing here, and really figure out how to. Well, it's like everybody here is a puzzle piece, right? We see the outside of the box, and we know what this image should look like, right? But we don't. All the pieces aren't flipped over. All the pieces aren't pressed together. And hopefully this weekend we can uncover that. And with your wisdom and your insight and all the research that you've done in your past, thinking about recollecting models and stuff that you've seen in throughout your research that we can apply to what we're doing now, because we can't use any of those models. We got to put all those models together, and some, maybe I don't know, feedback off me on that. Yeah.
Wow. You got it. I mean, you just did it. You just told us what the answer was. That was great. That was wonderful. It was wonderful. Way back there. You.
Would you mind if I just took this lady?
Sure.
This happens to be convenient.
Oh, wait a second. Then you are next.
That's all right.
And then there's somebody on this side of the room. I saw a hand. Oh, it's here, right there. That gentleman.
Well, it's okay.
I'm sorry. I feel like I'm jumping the queue.
That's okay. That's okay. We're
jumping the queue a lot. So I'm
We're saving him some walking distance.
All right. Hi, my name is Alex. I've been concerned about these sort of conversations that have been happening, it seems to me, in the progressive community after the election, where folks seem to be suggesting that we need to sort of focus on economic issues or economic inequality, and we should have to put aside so-called identity politics as though, you know, women and people of color and LGBTQ folks are not also of the working class, as though the working class is just, you know, white, straight men. And so I guess my question is, how can we, as we look towards systemic change, how can we make sure that we are not sort of building an implicit hierarchy of issues, as is, you know, some groups' issues are more important than others. And how can we sort of bring a lens of intersectionality and understanding that power, of course, wealth is a great source of power and inequality, but that there are other sources of power and hierarchy as well.
Yeah. I mean, I think you guys all know the answer to that is that's one. For instance, we on the website, the Next System Project, we deal a lot with that question. There's a lot of, because it has to open up at all these dimensions. If it doesn't open up at all these, and it's part of the question of community, it can't be just economic. I'm emphasizing the economics because it doesn't get in. It's not being talked about. Systemic design. It's just not there. We're finding people responding, and they know. I'll bet every person in this room knows there's a system problem. But then it means you need a system answer. So we're trying to elevate that and also to learn enough about it. I'm not trying to denigrate the other issues, and we try to bring it in. I know. I'm saying, if I have one thing, you know, you invite a speaker, so he thinks you must have something to say, right? If there's one thing I'm trying to say is, unless we understand that we actually face a systemic problem, not just a political problem, not just a cultural problem, not an environmental problem, no, it is a systemic problem that you aren't going to get the answer until you change the system. If you don't get that piece, you can't get to these others. The hierarchies get replaced and rebuilt one form or another. There'll be another discriminatory track as the inequalities have to be justified. My own view is, how do you start from community and build up? But that doesn't mean that you can move it, you know, it's all done. It's an agonizing, you want to play this game, the cost is 3 decades of your life. That's the cost. Look in the mirror tomorrow morning. Yeah, and that's openers.
What else are you going to do?
Yeah, well, that's what I always say. What else are you going to do? But I really want, I'm saying that, look in the mirror tomorrow morning. I always say that. You want to play you got 3 decades of your life? You up for that? I mean, that's what the game is. That's what it's about. So, you know, I'm preaching. Here I am. But I think that is the game. So over there, that young lady back here.
It's a good pulpit as well as lectern.
I love being in a friend's place.
Thank you for calling me young, so that not only adds to your speech, and thank you for being here. I feel somewhat like a fish out of water, as always, because I work for the enemy. I work for the federal government. And what I've seen in the past decades that I've worked there is the greatest transfer of wealth from public to private hand and the corporatization of our government. So I'm curious if it's just my agency or if you're agreeing with that is, you know, part of the enemy, so to speak. The challenge is that, you know, behemoth of just the agency I'm in just in the past 10, 15 years has mushroomed layer upon layer, and the mission is so bastardized in practice, but in the internet and in public sentiment. So it's really like opposite day, if you've ever had a kid, you know, where they play opposite day. So the mission is one thing, but the reality and the practicality is opposite day. So do you see that, you know, from, because you used to be in the government, and, you know, to me it's the evil, because I see things becoming secret. Like, they've hired in my agency about 700 IT specialists, and everything now is a private website. You have to have a need to know to go there. It's really truly like 19, I don't want to, but I mean, it's really truly like 1984. Yeah. And it's not where the missile silos are hidden. So it's really getting very scary to me. Right. You know, I don't want to, you know, bad enough I'm losing sleep reading all this stuff that we had to read for the course.
Let me ask you a question with high respect. You may not want to answer it, and I totally understand. Could you tell us what agency?
Yeah, I work for the Department of Veterans Affairs. Veterans Affairs.
So
I work for where the $182 billion, if you gave some to every veteran, should house, feed, clothe, you know, whatever.
Right.
And so it's very interesting. You know?
So the thing, I gave a talk to a bunch of, since I'm an old government hand. I was in the federal government, State Department, for 1 year, thinking I could do something about the Vietnam War. Right? they gave me a very high post. I mean, I worked in the House and Senate much longer than that. I get to occasionally speak to government people who are working in the bureaucracy. You can do a lot to help. You can do a lot to help people in and out if you understand yourself as part of the system changing process. And probably you do.
Well,
but self-identifying with others, how do we use this damn thing to move it up? People come for help and you can actually play a powerful role. People don't quite realize their power.
Yeah.
So you probably thought about that.
Well, we do, and I used to be the union president.
There you go. There you go. But for instance,
day, you know, but and still do,
yeah.
But it's becoming more. It used to be like Hogan's Heroes, where we were behind enemy lines trying to serve the
right
constituency, but now it's becoming
harder.
Very. It's a lot harder.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. They're going after the people.
Often, people working in city, state, and federal government can really help activists on the outside.
Yeah.
They've got a lot more power than they think. And anyway, just let's see. Back on this side, did you? Yes, yes. We'll go back and forth.
I'm just going to ignore all the people.
Anarchy,
calling.
That's good.
That's
another system.
My name is Marty Malloy, and I'm so grateful for your talk. I think all of us are, and I really appreciate that. You're pushing my boundaries, because I like to think of myself more of a radical incrementalist.
Mm-hmm.
And so the idea of full systems change is terrifying.
Yeah,
it's totally terrifying.
Well, thank you for that. No. That's really important that you said that. Thank you, because most people are scared to death of the idea.
It absolutely is. So, but I'm also incredibly curious, and so I'm hoping, can you elaborate a little bit just in areas of information? You've touched on a few things, like you mentioned the Evergreen Project in Cleveland and others. This idea of public institutions incubating and protecting worker-owned co-ops or other community local economy pieces, I'm really intrigued by this idea, because I think that they have, you know, not only the trust, but also the resources to be able to do that. So can you give us some other examples or just point us in the right direction?
Well, there's first that website, community-wealth, put the dash in, and you'll find thousands.
Okay.
But this is your question. This is like you're inside of the city government of every city in the United States almost, there is a Department of Economic Development. Usually, the Chamber of Commerce controls it, but not always. And often, there are people in there who don't know what they can do. They just don't know that you could do something more interesting. You could support a co-op. It's not in their mindset, because they've been doing the same game of tax credit for the tax bring in a company, and then the company goes. It's about $100,000 minimum a job now, per job. That's a tax giveaway to get a company to come in, and then they leave. But there are often people, if you approach them as people, like this, we have a bureaucrat, I was a bureaucrat, and you approach these folks as people and say, gosh, did you know what they're doing in Youngstown or whatever, Cleveland, and they're doing this whole interesting thing, maybe we could, and often as people, they can be approached with a view to what somebody else has already shown is possible. Maybe they could do it here. It doesn't, I'm not giving you lots of big picture, but it doesn't have to be wrapped in radical rhetoric. It doesn't have to call for the revolution tomorrow. It is, how do we build the next stage of democratizing the economy? I'm urging that you don't stop at democratizing the locality, because there's a whole local thing that gets crazy. You ain't going to do it locally alone. But it is important to do it locally. So I think our experience in many cities now is that folks are open to, indeed like to help. Now, not all of them. Some of them are really cornered by the Chamber of Commerce, but even some of the guys in the Chamber. We find conservative businessmen who actually will help you set up a worker co-op in the poorest black community. They want to help. They don't see it as revolution. They see it, maybe we can do something useful. Or these worker-owned companies, these guys have a piece of the action. You know, it translates for them. But they're hard, they want to work, they want to produce. So one of my best friends from kindergarten on is an extremely conservative kid from Racine, Wisconsin. We still keep up. Very strong Catholic, very conservative. But on the local level, he wants to help. It's not ideology. So I would translate it into do it, approach people, what you were talking, approach people as people and see what happens. And you may find, you know, you don't have to give them this whole radical rap. Yeah. You can say that for something else. But there are things that can be done. There are many, many. We're finding, the other piece I want to talk to you about briefly, hospitals and universities have huge budgets. And they don't quite realize how powerful their budgets can be if they start using it in the support of this kind of activity. And it's kind of, they just don't know. Or the procurement officer's been used to buying it from somebody XYZ, and he doesn't quite know he could make a bigger impact. So often it's a knowledge question. We're getting close to the end?
We are. Would you entertain?
How many do you want? It's up to you.
Raise your hand now. All right, we've got two more.
There's two back there. The young lady back there also had her hand up. Okay. Is there another one? Oh, yes. She.
Well, if we open it for a long period of time, that okay. will be here longer.
I guess we have four.
Okay,
right?
Four, that's it.
Four. One, two, three. Where's the fourth? You. Yes, that's right. Okay. I am really liking you guys. Thank you.
We're liking you too.
Thank you.
My name is George Lakey, and I have two short things. One is big appreciation for your use of the word design, because I think it helps us all with regard to the communication question that was brought up by our Transition Town friend. How do I communicate with other people about this? And it's great. I think that inside our bubble, we talk about the next system and that we can use jargon like that. But for approaching other people, to talk in terms of, I wonder if there's a way that we could design things here that would include you and include me and include the common good. And that word design is in not just not threatening, but it's actually inviting. So thank you so much for using that. Sure. And the other thing quickly is that good news, I think, is that the Movement for Black Lives on August 1st offered its vision of what might make racial justice possible in this mm-hmm. country. And it's very much addressing, as you know, it's very much addressing the economy. Yeah. And that breaking out from what sometimes gets ghettoized, as you say, as identity politics, well, it's always this identity, that identity. Here's the Movement for Black Lives setting a wonderful example of, yes, of course we're all about racial justice, and we know that that means intersectionality, and we know that that means addressing the economic system, and we just go ahead and put out a vision that proposes it. Thank you.
Great. There is this problem about capitalism, though, but we'll... I agree with you. Thank you.
I'm going to go here because it's very close.
One of the major aspects I see of the... Oh, Paul Crum, I'm from Kansas. One of the major existential issues I see in the economic issue is that those of us who are a bit better off and aren't just living day to day benefit from the system as well as pay into it. And because of that, we are bought into it. And that's one of the major fears of change, is somehow recognizing this and seeing to it that as we do a transition, that those who have benefited from the present system are taken care of, but not necessarily in the plush way they have been in the past.
It's a really important question of how honor that question, because the transition of people in privilege who are at different age, they've got the privileges there. They're not going to give everything up, but they could be allies. So it's a very complex question how one deals, particularly with older folks. I don't have a simple answer, but I'm glad you posed the question.
Do you remember who the other people were?
Right here, there's one, and one way back there. While you're back there.
Hi, I'm Muriel McCarthy.
Hi.
I live in Philadelphia. I've joined the Green Party recently. I voted for the Green Party. I feel that they're the answer. They are an established party. I've done nothing to help them except voted for Jill Stein last time, and I voted for Nader as well. I already was thinking outside of the system, so I agree that it's a systemic problem. My problem is I don't have any experience as an activist or as a citizen, if you want to be more exact. And I don't know how to talk to people about looking at the Green Party because it's considered a spoiler or it's so new. I went to a Green Party meeting last night and I was distressed by how disorganized it is. And it's people are doing all this grassroots, like you said, the basic work right now. And I'm reluctant as an individual to have to do all that groundwork because I have low confidence, I don't have experience, I have a lot of opinions, I read a lot. I read Chris Hedges, who's a Green Party supporter. He wrote a book called Wages of Rebellion. And he's talking about completely changing the system. And I came to this conference so that I could talk to other people about why they're not open to the Green Party right now, in addition to learning a lot more of other things. So I would invite all of you to talk to me about your views about the Green Party, why you might feel close to it, because I know I was close to it until recently. And I heard Chris at an event in Philadelphia, as well as other people, and I was just amazed by the intellectual substance of the party. It's the word green makes it sound like it's just an ecological movement. It's so much more, and it's everything you guys are talking about tonight. And I just want to put out an endorsement for that party and encourage you all to consider it and realize the structure is in place, the political structure is in place to put them in power very soon.
Thank you for that. What she's raising is, I mean, it is a question. Lots of people have issues about the party or not the party, and it's really glad. What I'm glad you did is open that out so we can talk about it. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Mariah. I work here at Pendle Hill, and I grew up right around the corner. Thank you for bringing the Green Party into this, and thank you for being here. As a young person, I felt very gung-ho to join the Green Party, especially after my experience at the DNC, being in the streets at the convention and just feeling this energy of these people that really have spirit and they want to change the system. So one thing I'm wondering is, how do we bridge the gaps between generations? At the convention I saw, you know, and all of these experiences that I've had since then, there have been various generations in, but in my own experience, I find it hard to connect with some older people, like my mom. It's hard to, you know, to get that, you know, that understanding of where she's coming from, but also where I'm coming from. I think one of the big things is the internet, that I have access to all of this at my fingertips, and she is you know, part like listen to the mainstream media, and not just her, but so how do we bridge this gap of generational, like learning from one another, us learning from you and experiencing your wisdom, but also the older generations learning from us as young people to know that we feel these things are wrong. And also spirituality, bringing that into that generational gap. Because I grew up in the Catholic Church and have completely, for a while, was like, no religion, none of that. But coming to a place of friends, I have, that's reinvigorated my spirits of just spirituality, not necessarily religion. So how do we like tie that also into radicalism with, you know, getting people to understand the Green Party, but also understanding, you know, where the system's coming from and where it could go, and how do we, you know, change those things intergenerationally?
I don't have an answer to that. But I do have one suggestion. I think the acknowledgement of ambivalence is really important, because a lot of us are ambivalent. So I confession. The head of the Green Party asked me to be her special advisor on new economic measures. So I am, but I have a lot of ambivalence about the Green Party, even though I signed up I'm your special assistant on the economy, but I'm Nader's a friend, and I have a lot of questions about all that. By the way, we don't have answers to all the questions. Very important to acknowledge, including ambivalence, because we don't. But, you know, that Conrad line is the important one, with the motion of your hands and feet. Even so, keep going forward, but acknowledge the ambivalence and the difficulty. And that's part of this. If we all had the answer tomorrow, it's all over. Wait. There are three or four other people.
We're going to be ending this with this gentleman, I believe, was number four on our list.
It's the start of a weekend. We can't always go late because we've got people who are commuting an hour from here. So. This will be the end for tonight.
Hi, I'm Tucker Taylor. I teach economics at Temple University and have contributed a chapter to one of the QIF pamphlets and been an active Quaker for many, many years. We're each tugging at a little piece of the blanket here. And the piece that I have been tugging at for most of my career has been problems of employment. And I think that full employment, absolute full employment, that is with an unemployment rate, official unemployment rate down around 2% or 1.5%, something like that, would go a long way to alleviate many of our social problems. It would assist, pull people up out of poverty, true full employment. The experiment with it that has come closest was between the Depression and World War II. In World War II, every warm body was needed to build nasty military stuff, but people were pulled out of sharecropping and poverty in the South by the millions, poured into the big cities of the North to build nasty stuff, of course, military stuff. But nevertheless, they were pulled into good jobs for 3 or 4 or 5 years. So they had good jobs with good wages, with benefits. They saved $3,000 or $4,000 or $5,000 and emerged 4 or 5 years later, astonished that they had joined the working class, the middle class, and could their lives were transformed. They were no longer helpless and no longer peasants, and they were, as I say, pulled into a working class and a middle class, and it was because of full employment. And I think if we had a similar sort of push today, and I think it should be focused on two things. I've written something about this. One, infrastructure, of course, improvement and repair and modernization, but the other is care. Care for our youngest kids, the preschoolers and infants and young, care for our youngest and our oldest. it's just disgraceful that our grandparents should be in places where they're not, you know, getting dignity and care. So between the infrastructure and the care, that would employ tens of millions of people. And a major push toward that could be at the basis for this new new system that we're trying to discover or create. I know you've written a piece sort of related to this, I believe, Garl Perez, I dare to call you that.
Yeah.
Do you want to expand on it or comment on it at all?
I'll make a brief comment because I'm being flagged down for the night. Was there one more comment back? I can't remember. There's one more, and then I. So let me make my brief comment, and all too brief, because I was trained as a Keynesian, left Keynesian economist, which is all about full employment. For those of you, that's inside ball game, which was the idea that there is no problem about full employment theoretically. The problem is political. That's the Scandinavian model. But the argument I'm making is that the institutional base, which was labor, is no longer available for that model. That's the model I came alive with. So I don't believe that the systemic base is available for the model that you advance, though it certainly would work if you, I mean, it's a growth model, so it's got environmental problems, because it tends to be a growth model, but you could probably, with the planning, you could probably turn the stuff into environmentally good stuff. But I think the institutional base is gone. That's my view anyway, that short view.
Thank you all. Thank you, Gar.
Hey.
I'm just going to make some announcements for logistics for the end of the night.
Good.
Yeah. My name's Lena. You guys saw me briefly earlier. A couple of things. I really want to invite